You know, the world is changing, and what we are trying to say is it has got certain implications for the way we do education in today's world. If we just look back, there are so many ways in which we see the world has changed, and not too far back, okay? Just last 15 years, things have changed so dramatically. Let's take any example, whether it is banking. How many of us actually visit branches as frequently as we used to do 10 years back? Or if you look at mobile phones, 15 years back, getting a landline was a 2-year wait. Today, almost everyone has got 2 mobile phones with them. One on Android, one on iOS, maybe one on BlackBerry, God knows. What does it mean for the children? We teach, someone mentioned in our earlier session also, that children tend to know a lot more than teachers today also. Why does that happen? If a child is interested in a particular thing, irrespective of whether it is taught in school or not, if the child is interested, the child has got n number of avenues to go and explore. Now, if we can control or direct what they are exploring, the benefits will be dramatically different if the exploration is uncontrolled. So that is one way in which, so learning as it is moving, it is more and more of a facilitation by the teacher and exploration by the child. That's what it seems to be moving towards. Many of you would have heard about this concept of a flipped classroom. How many of you have heard about that? The Khan Academy in the US. So they are piloting a concept called as the flipped classroom, where children study a given topic at home, they solve their own problems, and in the classroom it is more about a discussion. It is not new. Most of the management schools have the similar concept, where the case study, students study about a concept and the case on their own time, and the teacher mainly facilitates the discussion. The idea being to direct children to study in a given way, in a given format. What does it mean for the jobs? In the 1960s, if we had a graduation, it meant we had a job. In the 1990s, if you had a specific graduation, you had an engineering degree, a management degree, a doctor, you had a job. 2020s, what does it mean? No one really knows, actually. And if we just have to look around us to get a sense of why that is so. If we look around us, ignoring that we are in a school environment, if we just look around us, we see a whole lot of careers. It is no longer jobs. It is a whole lot of careers that are spawning. But if we look at, come back to this education system and look at how children are studying, it is typically, again, for the standard 3, education, medicine, or management. But we just look around, what is happening? Journalism, PR, event management, media. Media itself has got a whole lot of technical as well as non-technical roles within that. Cinematography, animation, huge, right? The number of career opportunities which are spawning are huge. But when do children learn about those? After graduation, when they are not able to find a normal job. That is when they go, find out a course, and hopefully parents allow them to pursue that course, and that is when they start looking at that. If we find out a child is really good at, let's say, dramatics, and encourage the child, maybe we would have had better content on the 24/7 TV channels, right? But that is not the case. What happens is, those who don't get a job in the preferred ones, go to that, and hence we are stuck with the kind of serials we get, where we just go, copy whatever is happening in the West, and create some sort of a format here. This is not a local phenomenon. For a change, we are on par with the world. If we are having some problems, everyone has the same problems, they have not cracked it, probably we will have a head start on that. Because just by virtue of the kind of demographic dividend that we have, the largest proportion of young people is in India. That is the reason we see all these people wanting to come to India, and we'll probably take a head start there. Some examples, anecdotal evidence. South Korea, one of the most literate and progressive nations in the world. 85% of the population is literate there. 50% of the graduates in 148 out of 205 universities are not able to find a job. A very similar phenomena in India. We have a whole lot of engineering graduates coming out today. The number of colleges that have sprung up or mushroomed is huge. And a person who has become an engineering graduate will not want to take up a job which is, say, a telecalling job. But the reality today is engineers are being hired at a significantly lower salary than telecallers. That is the reality today. Narayan Murthy comes out and makes a statement that not more than 25% of graduates are employable. But since I am already a graduate of a particular stream and society expects me to have a particular job, I will not do something else. So neither have I learnt what I want to be, nor am I able to do what I can actually do. In fact, that South Korea thing, interestingly, it has led to some sort of a policy. Many banks in South Korea have a reverse reservation where X percentage of their employees are not to be graduates. That's what they are getting into. They are wanting to discourage children from becoming graduates who are not really useful. Same thing with America. In a study done between 2005 and 2009, over 1 lakh PhDs were awarded, but only 16,000 new professorships were there. So what do the remaining 84,000 do? They don't want to go and teach in a school. I am a PhD from an American university. I don't want to come to India and teach in a school. So what do I do? I like this anecdote. Peter Thiel, he is the founder of PayPal and is known as a person who can anticipate bubbles a lot, whether it is the economic bubble or dot-com bubble or the housing bubble. He is one of those people who has not really fallen prey to that. He is one of the many people who are talking about an education bubble. Theoretically, what they are saying is the amount of money we are putting into education is not worth the rewards coming out of education. And to put his money where his words are, he has started a scholarship of $100,000 to students who prefer to drop out of college and start their own business. Very interesting stuff. So the world is changing. The future is unpredictable. What does it mean for us? We know that education is the primary vehicle which can really equip children to face this very dynamic future. So can we do something about that? Ken Robinson, all in education will definitely know him. He puts it very nicely that the best hope is for everyone to have a chance to do what they should be doing. It's not that nothing is happening. For a whole lot of things are already happening. There is a lot of technology. There are a lot of policy changes which are coming into place. The plethora of textbooks, the infrastructural changes that we see. Obviously, with each change, there will be X number of proponents, X number of opponents, but that's fine. That's how change happens. What we are trying to do today is focus on one aspect of this entire ecosystem, which is internal assessments. Detailed assessment as a product tries to focus on internal assessments and make it a powerful tool which can change one aspect of this. So why internal assessments? We talked about, I think Delhi University really became very famous. 99% they closed the admission list, which is, as someone said, just a symptom of the more problem. So why does that happen? Any part that we take, whether it is parents, students, anyone. I was talking to some teachers, and they said, can you devise a system which will help me award 2 marks if a student is able to formulate a question correctly? And another 3 marks if the steps are written in the order they are supposed to be written. I'm okay if this answer is not correct, because that is how the board exam evaluates. There are schools who start preparation for the board exam from January. So the curriculum is completed by December, and by January, it's just focus on board exams. One can't really blame them. That is how the whole thing is. Parents, Sridhar gave that interesting example that, okay, wooden spatula is not made of wood because the textbook does not say so. So you better study what is there. You might be using other things of wood, but those are not what are made of wood. Okay? Teachers, parents, everyone. Why does that happen? Because the entire ecosystem is focused on percentages. Now this is a challenge. But a challenge is always an opportunity also. So on one hand, the entire thing is focusing on something which is leading us in a negative direction. But the good part is, at least there is a congruence on what everyone is focused towards. So if that one thing can be changed, if we can change percentage, as a result of this, assessments tend to drive the whole education system. Now if we can just change that percentage to learning, the effort is already there from every stakeholder. But if we just direct them to measure something else, can it not make some fundamental changes in which we teach? That's the premise. And we believe that education can actually drive teaching for learning by using the same assessments which are becoming a problem today. That is where detailed assessment comes in. So what exactly is detailed assessment? It is a diagnostic topic test. The test that you took, instead of a normal school test on magnets, which would have say 5 or 10 questions, many of those are predictable by the students, so they prepare for the test. Instead of that, if they get this kind of a paper, the report which will come out of that clearly identifies the top 2 or 3 learning gaps that are there in class and also provides high quality remedial guidelines on how that learning gap can be closed, and all within 24 hours. So I have completed, let's say, magnet yesterday. Today morning I can take a test, and by end of the day I will have a report which says these are the 3 learning gaps on magnets in your class, and this is the way in which you can address that. How do we do that? I think the fundamental reason for any of these things is the in-depth research that EI does. That's the crux of everything that is coming out of it. Let me just show you with an example. So this happened only last week. One of our test development teams, we interact with schools a lot. So the test development team has a hypothesis that children will get confused with this kind of a question. This was in class 5. So this problem was given, 7 minus 2 by 3, 2, 3 by 4. These were the options, 1 by 4, 4, 1 by 4, 5, 1 by 2, 5, 3 by 4. The focus of this research is not only the correct answer, but more importantly, what is the most common wrong answer? Because the most common wrong answer tells us how children think. What could be the most common wrong answer here? Any idea? The answer is C. And do you know how children got that 5, 1 by 2? 7 minus 2 is 5, 3 minus 2 is 1, and 4 minus 2 is 2. So the answer is 5, 1 by 2. So this kind of engagement with children helps us come out with questions which identify these learning gaps. Now, the base, that was the base which translates into a diagnostic question which says 35-43/79. What operand can I use to get the largest number? Obviously, only 8% got it right, but more importantly, 85% of them got the same wrong answer, which tells how children are thinking. What does it say? It tells the teacher the children tend to think the division is basically reducing a number. That is how I think of it. So I cannot imagine division will actually result in an increased number. Now this learning gap, if it is known to the teacher, it is much easier for the teacher to go ahead and correct it. But how do you know this? It is not easy, because identifying these gaps is a specialized skill. Something simple. This is from class 6, lights and shadows. Write the definition of a shadow. I'm just trying to bring out the difference between the normal class test and what a diagnostic test can do to that. This is a fairly common one, which almost every unit test or summative test will have. Teachers will also know that, students will also know that. And by default, 98% of them will get it right. They'll get 2 or 3 marks for that. But do you just change that into a diagnostic question? The first time I read this, I was quite zapped. How can anyone think that there is a black light emitted from the body? Or there is a reflection formed due to the darker side? But by now there is no surprise that only 30% of the children really know what a shadow is. But would a teacher know that 70% of my class does not know what a shadow means? Even the thought doesn't occur to the teacher, right? There was talk of making learning more related to life. So this is a question which tries to highlight that. There is a bowl of ice cream. What happens when it melts? Molecules will absorb heat and start moving slowly. They absorb heat and start moving rapidly. They release heat, or same thing. What do you think the children would have answered? most common wrong answer. I think here in diagnostic questions, the most common wrong answer is more interesting than the right answer. No? First is the most common wrong answer. Why? Children see when the ice cream melts, it is moving slowly. So molecules are moving slowly. So the questions will identify a misconception. It will tell the teacher what exactly are children thinking. They will also give a remedial measure. For example, they are saying, ask children to rub their hands and see that the temperature has increased, and then explain that the molecules are actually moving much more rapidly now. Now, if this sequence is carried out, let's say I teach energy yesterday, I have this kind of an insight today, and tomorrow I conduct that experiment. What do you think will happen the next time a child is eating an ice cream? Right? Learning is much more real. Learning is much more applicable to what I am doing in life. So that, in short, is what a diagnostic detailed assessment can do for our normal tests. So what does the teacher report have? The teacher report comes out within 24 hours. That is the reason we use technology. So as far as we are concerned, technology is an enabler to assist real-time learning. So, Nitesh, can you distribute the paper? The report, teacher report. So within 24 hours, a teacher report will be provided to the teacher. It will have these following components. It will have the summary. See, each test, for example, you took magnets today. So magnets itself is subdivided into multiple subtopics. And each subtopic, the performance is given to the teacher, saying, okay, understanding of polarity is an issue or not an issue. So there is a summary that you get. Next, you get the top learning gaps on that topic in the class. Along with that, you get remedial instructions and, of course, the score sheet. Those of you who are aware of the teacher sheets, the reference to the appropriate teacher sheet is also provided in the remedial guideline. So teacher has a clear instruction or a framework that she can study and clear the learning gap in class. We will share. Fine. So we will be giving you all a copy of the teacher report, so you can just relate to our discussion when you go through that report.
Perhaps many don't understand that question, and therefore they just guess one answer and they get right or wrong.
Okay. Guesswork, while there is a possibility that a few children will simply guess it.
The point I'm making is that something must be done about the language also.
Agreed. Agreed. So that's a very valid point, and we have got that feedback from schools, so we will be working on that. We have already started to work on that. But in terms of the feedback for the teacher, I just want to highlight that even if a few children guess a question, it will not make any difference to the feedback at the teacher level, because each subtopic, the feedback is based on at least 4 to 5 different questions, and a child getting all of them right, the probability is extremely low, and the possibility of the class feedback being wrong obviously is too low to be meaningful. So as a teacher tool, the value is not compromised, but as a feedback for the individual student, definitely it is a very valuable feedback, and we are doing that. So a similar report is also given to each student, and it is available to the parents online. So the parent can actually see the report and the question paper, and in case they are wanting to engage, they will have some way in which to engage. Then there is a school report across sections. Now this is a very interesting report that we saw. There were 4 sections in a class. The same test was conducted for all the 4 sections. And you see there were 4 subtopics on which the test was conducted. You look at section A, that is the last bar. The same teacher, the same set of students, the same environment, everything is same. But the performance on symmetry of a shape is the poorest, and angles and measurements is the best. So there is something that the teacher is doing very right, and something that the teacher is not doing right at all. As school management, this provides you extremely pinpointed inputs for teacher training. So you really know now that, okay, this teacher needs some training on a particular aspect. So that kind of insight is available. So overall, for teachers This is mainly a tool for teachers. We want to convert the teacher time into a very effective time. So instead of the teacher spending a whole lot of time on correction or paper preparation, can the time saved be better utilized in effective engagement with the class? That is the basic idea. And we have seen this happen actually. We will see some of the teachers speaking about it. We have seen teachers really get energized. You all saw the questions. Did anyone of you really get bored with the question? I'm sure many of you would not have liked the question because we could not get the answer, but they were not boring for sure. So the subject becomes live, even for the teacher as well as the students. The engagement is better. For the student, it is definitely a lot more exciting, not only because of technology, because of the questions, and at a more fundamental level, you cannot prepare for this test, right? What do students do today? If I have got a test, 1 week later, I start picking up all the chapters which are going to come in the test and keep doing the same problems over and over again. With DA, you cannot. Even if the test is tomorrow after 1 month, I can only focus on understanding the subject. I cannot really prepare for the test on the last minute. So the stress levels tend to go down, and obviously the test is definitely very exciting for them. For the parents, they are much more engaged. Instead of scores coming over a period of time, I now have descriptive feedback coming as to how is the child learning. And if I choose to, which everyone should choose to, you have a better way of engaging with the child's education. And for the school, it ensures standardization in which assessments and remediation are done. We will see again from some of those principles that what many principals who have taken DA last year are doing is incorporating remediation as a scheduled activity in the teaching plan. So the day after the test is conducted, they use the reports and conduct remediation. So what is DA again? It is a diagnostic topic test from classes 3 to 10. It is available for all boards. We really don't go by board. We go by whatever you are teaching. Whether it is IB, CBSE, State Board, IGCSE, it doesn't matter. Whatever you are teaching, whether it is textbooks, learning objectives, or worksheets, we use that to create a customized diagnostic test. It is available for maths, science, and English. English, only the language part, not the literature. Last year, we had 60 plus schools who signed up for DA. 25,000 plus students are taking the test. As of date, more than 4,500, by now it would have gone to 5,000. Tests have been given to schools in these schools and covers all boards. Customized topic test, over 500 textbooks were analyzed by the team last year. So we really collect all the textbooks. We go through each textbook, identify what are the learning objectives, create a customized data bank. And what does that result into? For example, just fractions alone, there were 84 unique tests and 1,200 plus unique questions. I would invite Urmila ji to share her thoughts from the feedback. She has gone around the country visiting schools to take the feedback on whether it is actually translating into behavioral changes in the school or no. As Sridhar said, the first part is focus on outcomes. So she is the one who will tell us whether the outcome is happening or not.
Thank you, Vinay. A very good afternoon to all of you. Many of your faces are familiar, and I need to say hello at least during the lunch break because I've not met you all since long. Nice to have you all here. Hello. I'm a teacher. I've been in your shoes too as a principal. And I do understand the problems that have been raised, but we'll need at least a week's time to discuss it out. But there are solutions to everything. And I'm sure we as principals must have thought of it also. I had thought a lot about it. So coverage of curriculum is not a big deal if it is done in different ways. But anyways, this is not the platform to discuss that. We will surely interact over the emails. And let's share our thoughts among ourselves, how we will be able to cover the curriculum as well as find out new strategies so that learning with understanding happens in the classrooms. That's extremely important. I think you all unanimously will agree with me. And right now today, my focus is, as Vinay said, I visited about, out of the 65, about 20, 22 schools I've visited. Probably next month, I'm planning to visit another 7 schools in Bangalore. the purpose of my visiting these schools, by the way, let me tell you, I'm a part of the support team that takes care of teacher trainings per se. We do the physical visits to the schools. And I have my team members, for example, Deblina, she's based in Delhi, and she takes care of this region. So coming back to this, about 22 schools were visited. Let me be honest and tell you that initially when this product was launched in June, I remember I and Vinay were discussing the schools, you know, which would take this product. And we both were coming to a conclusion that even if 25 schools take it, it's great for us in the first year. But I am awed to hear later that about 60 plus schools have taken it. That itself indicates that it is the need of the hour. We as principals are seeing that continuous and comprehensive evaluation, which is the in thing now, not only in the CBSE schools. I can see a lot of other state board schools also following that practice. It's important that we do the continuous evaluation of students learning in the classrooms. So this product has been received very well. That is what my experience while interacting with the teachers, the principals, as well as the management heads, as well as even the students has come out. That is what I want to share with you all. Teachers, principals all started telling me that the quality of questions is great. And even you all have endorsed it just now. We will, when you did the 17 questions together. Some teachers told me that in Mumbai, that the concept of DA is extremely good. Detailed assessment, that's really good, and it's the need for the teachers. So they started taking it extremely positively. All of them felt, initially, I'm talking, when it was launched in June, July, they started feeling that it can easily be a part of the formative assessment. And that was being communicated to us through our team members who were there locally visiting the schools. And when I went, they said, we have already made it. Many schools told me, we have put it in our formative assessments. And so that was nice to hear. It was music to my ears. And I was very happy that we are able to contribute something to the school community, which requires something in their formative assessment part, which is really, really helpful. Teachers are very confused across the country. The formative assessment components take away a lot of the time of the teachers. So when we are taking away two key components of the formative assessments and helping the teachers do it in a very authentic way, I think it's pleasing them. They are happy. Principals are extremely happy. Yes, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu have started this unified curriculum process. And so the principals there told me, it will definitely fit into the CCE program that's going to be launched under this banner. Some teachers told me we are getting great ideas to teach. That's very interesting. Sir, I would like to go back to your point which you raised. It's important teacher training. I think all our products in some way or the other are motivating teachers to think. Yes. Yeah. They need direction. And that is why, you know, we, as Sridhar said, every product of ours has got some kind of support being provided. And let me tell you, it's going to be intensive next year in terms of support.
There, an average teacher goes to school at 8 and comes back at 5. She's teaching maybe 30 students. So those kind of facilities which enable them to have a one-to-one with many students, whether they are weak or average or excellent, that roadblock I don't see in the near future how we can overcome this unless we are prepared to pay teachers salaries like, you know, 1 lakh a month or something like that and reduce the number of classes they take. So we have to come up with techniques which will help us overcome those areas.
I remember attending a conference when I was with Aga Khan Services. I attended a conference on quality time spent by teachers in schools, and you know, and even student numbers that was discussed. That was the focus of discussion. And you know, there were many Asian countries participating in that, and many of the teachers who were present there said, "Let us stop worrying about." having 50-60 in a class, and let us find solutions of how to address those 50-60 so that they learn with understanding. And I think even in that workshop, which was about 3 days, we came up with tremendous good practical ideas which would help teachers, you know, to teach even a class of 50-60. So I agree with you that there are problems, but let me tell you honestly, I'm meeting teachers across the country, and you know, there's a ray of hope now. I can see about 40-50% of the teachers proactively doing things very differently when the curriculum is given to them, you know. And they are not worried whether anybody is seeing them or not seeing them, but they are very satisfied. They share this in the workshops. They tell us, I do this differently, I do that differently. And that's great to hear, you know. They're not walking on the beaten track saying that, okay, 15 lessons I have to complete and this is what I'll do. Instead of spending most of the time in the classrooms talking, I think they are doing things very differently. And this is really great to hear how in a country like India, where population is a big concern, at the same time student numbers cannot be decreased and teachers are doing meaningful things. Yes, the salary component aside, teachers are doing well. I think many good teachers are there who can become... Every school, all sitting here will agree with me, every school will have about 10 to 15% of teachers who are extremely proactive. I think if we bank upon them to guide the others, it works well. I did that as a principal. So I think it benefited me a lot. And I think that is the way others can also be allowed to grow and understand things and get the exposure required. But yes, there are many other solutions to it. Coming back to this discussion, as I said, teachers were very happy. They felt their time is being saved because they are not spending time building question papers. And somebody in the morning raised I think it was Anubha, who said the question making competition has been stopped and this is a big concern, because you want the teachers to learn it. Building good questions, indirectly building a good question paper, is a big concern for the principals. And here is a company like ours, which is doing so much of research. And when authentic question papers are given, even teachers appreciate it. They are happy their time is saved. Correction time. I'm sure each teacher must be taking at least a fortnight to give the results. It's just getting converted into marks and given away to the children. Whereas here, they are happy within 24 hours. Some teachers told me, we conducted the test in the third floor. By the time we came to the ground floor, the results were there in our email. So that was thrilling for them. They said, this is nice. Now we know what is the next step we have to take. And as Vinay said, remediation is suggested. Plus teacher sheets are there. They can use that resource. It's a perennial resource which is not going to die. Teacher sheets, which we have given to schools. It's a resource which will help the teacher day in and day out. If she understands how to use it, if she asks questions to us and try to improvise upon her teaching, I'm sure the teacher sheets and the remediation suggestions given in the reports are going to be very, very helpful to the teachers. And let me tell you, my experience in interacting with the teachers tells me that they are using it diligently and religiously, and it's helping them. Students are excited, yes. Technology is something. Some students said, we have not to prepare for the test, so we like it. You know, they're very happy about it. Some students said, we have to think a lot. Where did this idea come to you for building such questions? That's the kind of questions they ask us. There were issues. I'm talking about all the good things. Paper consumption was an issue. Teachers were feeling that they were using the mobiles to feed in the answers. So teachers felt that we are spending away too much time. One principal even calculated the number of periods they have spent. She feels she has wasted time. You know, all these were the issues, I think, but we have found solutions to that. Next year, as you all, I think Vinay will talk about it, the total logistics in terms of getting the paper done by the children, collecting it, doing everything will be from our side. Teachers will only have to enjoy the reports, read through it, and remediate in the classrooms. This is the best teacher training support that we will provide, and which is scalable. Plus, we will have our support team going to these schools. For example, if I'm one of the support team members in the country, I will be having about 25-30 schools with me, which I will be continuously interacting with the teachers, with the school's core team, to help them remediate, to see whether they are remediating, to guide them if they are stuck somewhere. You know, this is the kind of support we are going to provide. And I think this will take DA to a next level and it will help the schools. Yeah, I'd like to share some of the best practices. Yet we have not completed 1 year. But schools have started, you know, doing several things which definitely needs to be discussed in this platform. You know, teachers have to make requests for tests on the system to us. Now, all the teachers find it, they're not techno-savvy. Or secondly, they don't have time. Proxy periods are very, I'm sorry, I don't want to discuss that. But teachers don't get time to do all this. So some schools have found out ways and means. They have given that responsibility to the computer teacher. She has maintained a register. And the computer teacher collects all the requests. There's a format which is there. The computer teacher collects all the details of the topic, the date when the teacher wants to conduct the test. You know, all those details are collected and the teacher signs and leaves that. That format, the computer teacher then shares it with the principal for her endorsement. And then the request is made by the computer teacher on behalf of all the teachers. This is really a good practice, I feel. It streamlines so many problems for the teachers in terms of they may not have the time to do it, they may forget to do that, make the request, the paper may not reach them in time because they have not made the request, because we have made it very clear, at least 8 or 10 days before that they have to make the request. So all this is sorted out and schools are doing it very well. Some have started incorporating the questions of our question papers into their summative assessments because the quality of the questions is good. Again, let me tell you, teacher sheets are being used for remediation. Some schools told me they have replaced their unit tests by our DA papers. So something has been scrapped and our papers have come in place there. So teachers are not burdened. Even there, the correction work is totally minimized. And even the results are authentic. Parents are getting detailed reports. So things work very well. Subject teachers sit in groups. That's very nice. So that's the best way of internal teacher training. You know, if there are proper subject coordination meetings happening where the subject HODs can guide the teachers, maybe they discuss, if it is a DA school, they may discuss the reports. Okay. They may talk about the kind of remediation they are doing. Yeah?
Don't get me wrong. I think DA is an excellent service that you are providing. In fact, we were onto this ourselves. We were trying to do it ourselves, use OMR sheets, this, that, and the other. But there was a lot of resistance from teachers. Of course, this costs money, but it definitely does everything for the school.
Yeah. It not only helps...
And it helps the teacher to learn more.
Right.
But I still feel there is a lot of scope for teacher training.
You mean to say physical teach, a person coming and doing a workshop in connection to that?
It's not like something on the line that has been suggested earlier.
You're saying, if I understand right, some of these things are leading to informal and unplanned teacher training, but what is required is a more structured and planned way to upgrade the skills of teachers.
As a new product.
Correct.
From
correct.
Your
company. I agree. So that is something which I think Sridhar and Sudhir will definitely take it.
Yeah, I think we'll give a thought to it. In the formative assessment part of the school's program, I'm talking about the continuous and comprehensive evaluation program, our DA is fitting into two major components of it. There are projects that the children have to do. There are MCQ type of question papers, which teachers can build and use it as a part of the component, formative assessment component. We fit in very well in both. You know, and I liked one suggestion that came from the teacher community as well as even the principals taking DA. They said that after 4 DA tests, can we have a test paper which can become a part of our summative, the objective part of the summative paper, where it will be a combination of all the topics that have been covered in the first term through your DA as well as in the classrooms. And that was a great idea. I think we need to give a thought to it. And that is, again, pulling us even into the summative assessment component. We are going to contribute there. So she said, instead of having all 8 tests like that, can the 5th test... be a summative test paper of all the 4 DAs, and then end of the year also 1 paper like that. No, it's going to be a part of the summative.
questions there only.
That's so great.
It is a very important part of a teacher to set up the question papers. If the summative are also coming from your side.
I think you got me wrong. I'm just saying summative mein jo objective component hai, only that should come from us. The 3/4 of the paper, the teacher has to build it and she has to correct it because we don't get into the subjective question making. So, I remember in science we used to have, even in the summative exam, science, maths, we used to have objective type of question papers with 10 or 15 questions were made. That can be taken, but again, that is just a suggestion. If you want it, it can be done. That's one which is being suggested by the principals. Yes, I think I've covered everything is, I'll not say everything is green and rosy. We are having hiccups, problems. That is why forums like this are utilized for getting feedback, even our visits to the schools. You know, we get a lot of feedback and we in EI take feedback very, very positively. And I think, I think we are trying to even implement the given feedback, or later if that feedback is not implementable, going back to the principal to justify why we are not implementing it. But otherwise, feedback is most welcome. I'm sure many principals sitting here will have a lot more to say. You can share your thoughts. And I pass on the mic to Vinay to take it up.
The biggest problem we faced this year was that the DA would start only in July.
Yeah. Since we started only in June last year, this year it will be available from the time you start. So we just launched it in June last year, so there was some delay. I agree. You paid for 8 tests, you can use those. See, last year, some of the principals were telling me, you know, we hope, you know, that we will not have any problems. And we said, definitely you'll have problems. There is no doubt about that. We are getting in mobiles, trying to train a whole lot of teachers and, you know, all kinds of things. But equally guaranteed is that we'll resolve the problems on time and ensure that you're using the outcomes from the program the way you're supposed to use. And I think that is broadly happening. See, the two main things which came out from the feedback. One was this paper consumption and the second was teacher training on technology. We are trying to work on that, and next year a detailed assessment is being offered on tablets, what you just saw right now. It is a complete solution where, for example, in Delhi there will be a hub, so there will be an office with tablets. We will be conducting maths and science papers on tablets, and as you said, sir, ki the screen size is small, so English will be on a printed paper and the answers will be entered on mobile, but the entire technology part will be handled by a team from EI. So the team will come with the infrastructure, they'll conduct the test, go back, handle whatever duplicate responses, everything is there, so the report is available, and then the process starts. So this is how the teachers actually request the test. This is the online system. So if you see, class 4 maths teacher logs in and she sees the textbook chapters listed there, and the teacher selects whatever chapters I want for the test, the date on which I want the test, and then the same thing is delivered online itself. So this is what we really hope to achieve last year, that will accelerate the school's effort for teaching, for learning. It will improve the teaching effectiveness. It is enjoyable for students, it will be customized and should provide good remedial guidelines. And this is what schools had to say.
The test administration is the simplest thing. You just give it to the children, they pretty much finish it off in like 15-20 minutes.
The report is very good. It is, everything is given in detail. So, you know, when you look at the report, you will get to know. It is very clear, actually.
Concept based more than anything else. They tackle understanding. tested understanding. That was more important for me. It is not direct from the book. You take only the content of the book and you frame the questions, not from the book.
Because they are of really good and excellent quality. The way the children have to give a thought to the question and answer.
It has reduced our work a lot. But giving the quality paper also, I think the papers are of very good quality. The questions are concept based and very creative questions.
They have tailored it, they have tailor-made it for our school. So that fits us, that suits us.
So you are putting it into the formative assessments?
Yes, it goes into the formative, yes.
I tell my children now, you should know how to use the textbook to the maximum. So even extra information are given, sometimes in our question paper we may not include, but here, they are strangers who are looking at your textbook, so every nook and corner of your lesson you need to
use. When you solve these questions and all, it's definitely that it is going to help them to do their competitive exams, which are going to be like this in future.
We are using detailed assessment as a tool for measuring our performance, teachers' performance, as well as students'
Since we get the results so fast, we can immediately plan out the thing which are the gap which is there in the
They're quite clear about where we have gone wrong, where we haven't explained in detail. So we know where we stand actually.
This is the most beneficial part of the year because the feedback is immediate, remedial is immediate, and children really tend to learn from the mistakes in due sense.
The remedial answers come back to us the next day, and we do remedial immediately because we do each and every question in class.
It's a time hybrid, right? Then they have to recollect what they learned earlier, what mistakes they made, or they might have forgotten everything. But if you do it immediately, they will remember the mistakes they have made, and it's easier to correct themselves also.
The topic-wise assessment is being done. The child is more aware. He knows where he has to correct himself, where he has to spend more time. And then probably, you know, that slight push in the detailed assessment results will definitely encourage him to do better in the process.
The remedial would be like the next year when the teacher is going to teach the topic, the lesson plan has to be changed now for the next year. So there may be nothing we can do now. So we can't go back and teach again the whole thing again. So we may as well go ahead, but then rectify the errors in the coming years.
We are using it not just as a remedial. In fact, at least in English, I use it. When I teach, it strikes me, this may become a misconception. So before it becomes a misconception, let me set it right.
The teachers also have developed some spirit of showing more enthusiasm in bringing the children to understand what they are teaching. They have also improved.
As a teacher, it helps me think more. And by doing my scope and helps me set my papers, giving similar options. Great. That helps me.
I know that this chapter is coming for me. So I have to start thinking what can be the practical question, and that I put them in their class. So that also happens.
Now teachers are more focused on teaching. We are not spending time on paper setting and correction.
They got an opportunity to do something better than what they were doing the regular stream of education.
Guesswork and started writing map. But then as I ventured in map, I used to write the meaning according to the context map. So if I say a sentence in the same context as the sentence in the passage, I can use that word. So that's how it helped me.
My parents, like, they're happy. Like, in maths, my speed was always slow. I was slow in it. And now, because of detailed assessment, it has actually improved my speed in it.
We are also very happy that you are connecting to GSS because you give the question earlier than the syllabus. You don't have to read only the textbook, you should also read the textbook.
since our first DA test was math, our whole class was like shocked because it was our eight teachers. And when they found out that we had to do it on mobiles, they were all like looking forward to the next one. Mm-hmm.
So what happens is if you attempt a lot of application questions, it becomes easy to write all the knowledge questions. So it becomes easy to write the definitions when you know where to use it. And it helps in a lot of competitive